Associate Professor, Department of Psychiatry, Tripura Medical College. Academic Coordinator, Dr. Movinda Lake. IQAC Coordinator, Dr. Shushuman Sengupta. All the heads of different departments, faculty members, staff, and my dear friends, I, Vibhasha Chakravarti.
And I, Shashwat Chopra, first semester Department of Psychology. Welcome to all. Today, we have gathered here not only to observe the birth anniversary of Martin Seligman, father of positive psychology, but also to integrate mental well-being club in our college. We have with us our distinguished guest, Dr.Santanu, Associate Professor, Department of Psychiatry, Tripura Medical College, who will be delivering a special lecture on mental health and well-being on this occasion.
We start our program with a prayer song by the students from the Department of Psychology and Social Work.
Something very novel and very noble cause for which we are gathered here today. At the very outset, once again, I appreciate the initiative and work from the Department of Psychology along with the academic coordinators and IQAC coordinators and so on. I know we want to begin new club. We have many clubs and committees, but to make our life and work all the more smooth, richer, and academically also to focus and orient our study and life, we are beginning a mental well-being club today. This because in the very outset of the commencing of the Department of Psychology as a major course in our college, I think it is very appropriate and a very good effort, because we know today we are going to hear a lot about both scholarly and scientifically from Dr. Ghosh about what it means to have mental well-being or mental health. We used to say that it's only in a healthy body, a healthy mind rests, healthy mind and heart we can act, as we are always concerned about educating our own hearts and minds. So also we can say it's only in a healthy mind, or when we have a healthy mind, we can enjoy a fullness of life or a healthy life. I'm sure from that perspective, with this modern world where we are too much worried and stressed out, we are running after for too many things for which are very often insignificant, worthless, so to say. Because what matters is to find meaning in life, to have a purpose in life, and so on, which are really affordable and reachable in our capacity. But very often we are chasing, as you say, children, we want to catch the moon and stars and so on. So perhaps we are stressed out, we are disoriented, now we are frustrated, depressed and so on, we suffer all of this. Mental well-being, mental health itself is an important concept, I know, and it speaks about also our desire to live a life of wholeness, a life with a purpose, a life principled around values, universal values of justice, love, peace, caring, sharing, compassion, kindness, reconciliation, all these things. When all of these values are missed, we become more primate type, animal type. We lose our humanity, so to say, perhaps, so that we are after our own self-serving needs, like we are running after to get, perhaps, to become the most wealthy or famous persons, and then we are running after luxury plus name, fame. We become greedy, exploitative, distrusting others, violent, and all kind of things makes us mentally sick. Therefore, I think we are beginning with a good start. We have the right people here, like the doctor and the scholars and so on, to speak about mental well-being and health. I once again appreciate and congratulate the students who have gathered, both from psychology and other departments, because we have a lot to learn from. I am sure it's a good beginning. From now on, at least we can support one another, and can look forward to forums and places and people to help us in need of our enjoying our life with good health, good values and principles, living a life of joy, happiness and peace. So wishing all the same for as a commencement of this club today, Mental Wellbeing Club. Wishing you all the best and one and all. Thank you, sir, for your time, your presence, sir. Have a good day.
Thank you, Father, for your valuable words. We request Madam Devanchana Mukherjee, HOD, Department of Psychology and Convener of Mental Wellbeing Club, to deliver the welcome letters.
A warm welcome to each and everyone present here. In Holy Cross, we always try to help students to develop holistically, and we give mental health a very important aspect in developing to the holistic achievement level. Though Holy Cross College is working to maintain a balance between the student life achievements and mental health, since 2014 we have a counseling psychologist cell here. But still, This time, with the changing needs of the society, we have recognized that there is a need that we should establish a club where students can come up and where we will work not only for mental health, also for the well-being of the students of our college. This day, we are gathered here for two events. First, observance of birthday or birth anniversary of Martin Seligman. He is also known as the father of positive psychology. I want to mention one thing, that in the history of psychology, it has been seen that with us. Thank you so much. Now, I will request our MCs to take over the charge.
Thank you, Madam. Oshiki Bhattacharya, second semester, Department of Psychology, will be giving a presentation on father of positive psychology, Martin Seligman. We request her to come up to the stage.
Dr. Ghosh, kindly come up on the stage. Father Kitbok, Father Principal, Ma'am Momita, Sir Shushobhan, to kindly come on the stage for the inauguration process.
Of general psychology survey published in 2002,
78% is the 31st most cited psychologist of the 20th century. In Authentic Happiness 2002, he explains that his journey towards this new field of psychology started off in a study on learned helplessness in dogs. He is the founding editor-in-chief of Prevention and Treatment in the APA's electronic journal. The goal of positive psychology is to provide individuals and society with the tools of burnish rather than dwell on mental health. Seligman believed that such a new research-based approach could guide individuals toward flourishing, living a satisfying life, and also raise the bar of the human condition. Seligman, along with the psychologists of Felicia and Timothy So of Cambridge University, United Kingdom, found that flourishing is crucial to positive psychology, and to flourish, we must experience all the positive emotions, engagement and interest, and meaning and purpose, and at least three of the following additional features: self-esteem, optimism, resilience, vitality, self-determination, and positive relationships. Mental well-being. Mental well-being or mental health is a state of being that enables to cope with the stress of life, realize their abilities, learn well and work well, and contribute to their community. If we are experiencing mental distress, we can talk to someone we trust or seek help from a mental health professional. Now, we will see some of the applications of positive psychology in our daily life in various aspects. In work, positive psychology can help employees be more engaged, productive, and innovative learning, which will lead to job satisfaction. In the field of education, positive psychology can help students set goals and feel more accomplished when they achieve them. In relationships, positive psychology can help people spot strengths in their relationship. And in an overall view, positive psychology can help in mental health through clinical psychology and therapy. Thank you.
We are honored to have with us Dr.Santanu, Ghosh, Associate Professor, Department of Psychiatry, Tripura Medical College, and we request him to deliver his valuable insights regarding mental health.
Thank you. good afternoon. Respected father, principal sir, respected teachers and students. I am very honored and happy that today on the occasion of inauguration of the Mental Health Wellbeing Club, I am being invited. Really, I am being overwhelmed with the happiness and joy that you have given me this respect. Coming to today's topic, what is mental health and why we need it and what is the significance for it? I'll share my experience of last 15 years with mental health and the business to me. In the year 2008, I got MD. By that time, I was married. So, selection of psychiatry was not predetermined idea. It was by chance. What happened, when I entered the counseling room, my hospital superintendent that time in Guwahati Medical College, Professor George Sharma, he was there in the counseling room. And he said, there is a subject in psychiatry, don't take other subjects, go for this. From that point of time, I ran as one of my seniors. He's a professor in textbook, regional mental health center there. He's working as a professor there. I called him. Dada, what to do? He said, ask me, what a degree or diploma? I said, degree. Loilo, aloilo, next in accident. To teach you, you take psychiatry. Then, again I entered the room. I take psychiatry. After the completion of the process, when I went out, I called my wife. By this time, the legal activity was being over. So I called my wife. I informed her that the name of your father is psychiatry. Oh, psychiatry, you have taken psychiatry. London, you have done. Now you see level that Magulomara. This is my life experience. I say, I explain that this subject will teach me how to be a good happy, how to be a good son, how to be a good husband, and when time comes, how to be a good father. This subject will teach me. And believe me, it's a story of 2008, now standing in front of me in the year 2022. For a single moment, I never felt that I have made mistake. Rather, I say, yes, it was my wife, sister, and with the help of my teacher, I am one of my siblings. So with this story, I am studying. In the process of my discussion or talk, coming half an hour to 45 minutes. Ladies and gentlemen, we'll come to know two aspects of what is mental health. What, who is a mentally healthy person and who is an unhealthy person? What about the disease burden, about this condition, and lastly prevention. In between, I will try to emphasize on two main aspects of today's problem. The burning issues of Tripura, one is addiction and another is suicide. If time permits, I will cover. I will touch few lines on this. Now, what is mental health? You all know what is health, by explained by Dr.Santanu. It's a complex mental complex physical, mental and social well-being, not merely absence of any disease and infirmity. Everybody, we are aware of this definition. But regarding mental health, WHO has taken defined that. My biggest regard has this sentence we have presented. Mental health is the state of well-being in individual realizes his or her potential, your abilities, can cope with the normal stresses of day-to-day life, can work productively. If I am unhealthy mentally, I won't be able to give my services as a faculty, as a clinician, or as a respectable citizen of this country. And is able to make contribution to his or her community. This comprises the destination of mental health and human rights, world health organization. The whole definition, few components are there. Like, it is the person has to realize his ability, he has to understand his potential, he has to cope with the day-to-day life stresses. At the same time, he has to contribute to his community. If his everything goes fine, then only you will level as a mentally healthy person. Let me put this definition. I'll come on to the practical aspects. Little bit of problems statement or disregarding in the entire population. The point prevalence is it's the newly diagnosed case and old diagnosed case in a given period of time divided multiplied by 100. The prevalence is around 10% and 90% of among us are healthy, but only 10% is mentally unhealthy. A little more on that is part. 1.2 lakh people commit suicide every year in India due to psychiatric illnesses. 60% of the death can be prevented with proper counseling. A morbidity contributes disease condition. A morbidity of 40% was detected in one of the studies in primary care evaluation of mental health disorder. India has the least number of psychiatric clinics in comparison to developed and developing countries. I remember one patient. She was an OCI, overseas citizen of India. Basically, they are from Vilasar, but they have now settled in New York. The lady developed schizophrenia, and the system of US is like that. There is a hierarchy of doctors. First, the family physician will see. Then you refer to the second line of doctors. Then you refer to the third line of doctors. In this way, the hierarchy is maintained. As because their population is less and facilities are more. So they have made the system like that. Practically, that lady never reached to the top level of among the psychiatrists. They came back to India and now her husband is a faculty engineer now university in India. Till then, they are in contact with me and she is on the way. Mortality costs due to neuropsychiatric disorder is 2.2 in women and 2.1 in men. Statistical data. Coming to needs on mental health. See, it's a taboo subject. Many times you have seen that just now I have given you the example in my life. That everybody is afraid of this subject or this disease or ignorance. Our society is very much ignorant about this subject. I'm giving one example. Suppose you have pain abdomen or you have headache. You are consulting your tumor problem. But you are afraid in consulting a doctor if you have some pain in your mind. And at the same time, you cannot realize and you do not feel that you are having pain in your mind. Suppose any stressors or any odd things that happen in your life. Suppose you are failing the exam, or if there is a relationship problem, or there is death of your near and dear one. the problem in your life. So after the occurrence of such issues, you will develop unhappiness and quite these problems will reach a certain level that you won't realize that this is really making your hampering your day-to-day life. In this aspect, due to our ignorance, we are not aware of our problems. We do not consult or we do not seek help from the physicians or the mental health professionals. So, due to this ignorance, it has become a taboo subject. So, coming on to the myths, we generally believe a mental patient is a mad. This mad is an obsolete subject. As of today, we must not label a person as a mad. He may be mentally challenged or he may be mentally disabled. We cannot tag a particular person that he is mad. Again, it is mental. So it is a myth that a mental patient is a mad man. See, out of all patients, one person, out of 100 patients, one patient may be a man in the common language. But 99% psychiatric patients are of neurotic nature, neurotic mild kind of mental, like anxiety, depression, OCD. These problems are of milder in nature. They are not at all mad. So it's a myth. Next, consultation with a psychiatrist is a socially distressed. Suppose, I have seen many of my colleagues also, after consultation, when they are about to leave my clinic or my chamber, then this don't disclose this to others. Because they are afraid that if somebody comes to know that both these areas, they are examination. So again, it's a myth. Have you ever think that if you have pain abdomen, you are discussing with your classmate that yes, that I have pain abdomen. But why you are discussing, no, I have some psychic issue or mental health issue. So this is out of our ignorance we are making this subject a taboo subject. There is no cure for madness. Practically, with the advent of psychopharmacology, post-2000, there is revolution in the treatment modality or treatment protocol of this mental health. So, this is a myth that these are non-cure. It's a treatable, absolutely treatable. Few diseases absolutely get cured and some diseases will be rid of symptoms remains. These are what diseases happen when you are bothered by ghosts. Even yesterday, one person from Manisha, he's a drug addict, he has seizure disorder, also he has panic disorder. Now, he has to go back to Manisha because he has an interview to face. So, on request, he took this job. Now, in the evening, his mother called, "Sir, we are now consulting a failure. Uja will go." So, they think that people from the villages, their related persons, they think that many times due to the possession of ghost, these symptoms, this disease happens. Here, doctor cannot do it. Coming to who is mentally healthy person? First criteria, a person who is not at work with self, free from internal what is conflict. Conflict is a situation when a person cannot decide which way he wants to go. Suppose, madam, 3 years down the line you will be getting married. So you have got proposal from 2 or 3 persons. Now at this moment, you are not able to decide in which person you will choose. So this condition is conflict. It's a situation when a person cannot decide which way he or she should go or not. Here, next is well-adjusted means a person needs to be a well-adjusted within the society, within the community. He accepts criticism and not easily accepts. Suppose somebody rebukes me or somebody criticizes me about my mistakes, I should be ready to accept all these things. If I am a mentally healthy person, I will accept such criticism and I will reply that. But I am an unhealthy person with a depressed person. Yeah, people are, you know, little bit of criticism they are able to face. So they are able to take down the symptoms to have it. Next is, he searches for identity. Everybody in our society needs identity. A person who has developed identity crisis, he lands at the problem. Has a strong sense of self-esteem. Self-esteem, a person who has lost self-esteem, generally develops mental health. Knows oneself, one's need, problems and goals. What should he do? Where to reach? He knows. A mentally healthy person is self-criteria. Has good self-control, balances rationality and emotionally. I'm giving one example. During the viva, if you are not able to answer any answer, who cries fast? A female student or a male student? It's a general question. During the viva, when you are being asked a question and you are not being able to answer, who cries fast? A girl or a boy? Why? The science behind this is the expression of emotion is more vivid or more severe in case of female than male. It is due to the size of amygdala in our body, in our brain. Amygdala is a part of the limbic system. Size of amygdala is like a hammer. If you compare male and female, size of amygdala is more in female than male. That's why emotional outbreak is more in female than in male. He tries to cope with stress and anxiety. See, in every step of your life, you have to face anxiety or stress. Now, a healthy person can easily handle this, and an unhealthy person cannot. So, these are things, characteristics which are present in a mentally healthy person. Now, some warning sign of poor mental health. When you live in this particular person, an unhealthy person or mentally unhealthy person. First is always worrying, unable to concentrate, stress, anxiety. This little thing, he is not able to withstand those who are, he is not able to face those stressors. Next, he is satisfied and upset. Suppose have scored 99% time or 9.5 or 9.8, even though you are not happy, always dissatisfied. If a person remains dissatisfied, whatever amount of labor he or she puts, he will never be a happy person. Insomnia means lack of sleep. Mood fluctuation and a lower. Is that the findings in depression? Unhappy and lose temper easily. Many different things, many small things. There is a clash in the mountain with the husband and wife, brother, sister, boyfriend, girlfriend, anything. So this irritability, again, is a sign of unhealthy mind. Few more warning signs like eating or sleeping too much or too little. In depression, what happens? The appetite goes down, or the libido goes down, or the sleep goes down. Generally this happens, but in atypical depression, there will be increased sleep, there will be increased appetite, there will be increased libido. Pulling away from people and usual activities. A patient who is suspicious, he remains within a room, or he doesn't mingle up with other people, he remains alone. He never participates in any social activities. Having low or no energy, it happens in depression. feeling numb or like nothing matters. There are some physical symptoms which you cannot explain medically. Suppose suddenly a person becomes blind or he becomes paralyzed. But with investigation planning or examination planning, you cannot reach towards any disease, any condition which can lead towards blind. So these are things which may be a manifestation of unhealthy mind. Smoking, drinking or using drugs more than usual, feeling unusually confused, forgetful or angry, upset, worried or scared. All these are the warning signs when these symptoms such that a person definitely he or she is having unhealthy function. Now how to prevent this mental illness? What are the steps you can take? See, Halifax College has initiated novel concept that mental well-being club. It's a very, very appreciable thing. I am not aware any of such institutions in the entire Tripura or Agartala has taken this initiative. Not even any medical college. See, as of now we have had 3 medical colleges now today, but not a single, even in my college, there is no club which is dedicated towards mental health. Even all big shot school colleges and professional colleges are there. MIT, all universities, no map. I was a part of Tripura University, never, there also I haven't seen any club like which is a dedicated club for mental health promotion. So I am really happy and appreciate this college authority that they felt the need of the hour. So coming to the prevention. See, prevention it's a medical thing that prevention can be given in 3 or 4 parts. Primordial, primary prevention, secondary prevention, tertiary prevention. Now regarding mental health, what is the primary health, primary prevention? Primary prevention operates on a community basis. That is, for the appearance of the risk factor. Suppose, this particular group of students, their performance in the class is not up to the mark. They are in high risk group, and there is a chance that few years down the line, they might develop depression due to their poor performance. So what we will do? We will isolate them and we will give them special training so that they can be upgraded to the other students, other classmates. So this is called primary prevention. Secondary, it consists of early diagnosis of mental illness and social and emotional disturbances through screening programs in schools, universities, and the community. We are going towards the community and finding who are sick people, because people do not know, people are not aware that he or she is having some issues. So we are the professional, we are going to the community, we are going to school, college, university, and trying to find out those persons who are having mentally some mental symptoms. Then tertiary prevention will take 6 to reduce the duration of mental illness. Suppose there is a patient of depression. So we will give them early diagnosis, early intervention so that he comes to the pre-morbid condition. Before we will, our idea is to push them towards the pre-morbid, that means before the occurrence of the disease, we want to take him back to the previous situation. So this comprises the prevention, how to prevent this mental this is a myth on drug. As of today, we have seen that drug issues and suicide is a burning issue in our state. Probably you have come across one article that this month got HIV infection. Probably 1 or 2 months back, and the Honorable Supreme Court has taken a case to find out why this is happening. So basically, this is due to the use of intravenous drug. So what happens? 4 or 5%, they are injecting drugs. In local language, it's called coca. Basically, these are opioids, like brown sugar, heroin. They inject. So insulin, now the cost of insulin is 10 rupees. So 4 or 5% today he spends 10 rupees, tomorrow he, then they will protect some of them. In this process, infection from, what are the infections? Like HIV, hepatitis C virus, hepatitis B virus, this infection transmits from one person to particular. So that is the reason why there is such a HIV patient in our state. Now what is, now regarding drugs, before that, what is drug? Suppose, I am giving one example. I am hypertension patient, my temperature is normal. So in the morning, I take one medicine. Suppose you are having fever, you are taking paracetamol. Is it drug? Then why we are discussing about the bad things of drug? Is it thing? We are discussing about illicit drug. What is illicit? What is, before that, what is drug? Drug means any substance which is not a food, which is being used for, when it is being ingested, it has a capability to change the physiological system in our body. Or in other way, these are the substances which are not food, which we use for diagnosis, treatment of a disease and prevention of a disease. Let me give you one example. Suppose I am just giving that, I said that I am anti-hepatitis medicine. So this medicine, what we do, once they enter into our body, they will change the physiology. How there is a suppose the high blood pressure is high, this medicine will lower my blood pressure. That means it changes the physiology of my body. And this medicine, this drug I am using for the treatment. Suppose 2 years back, you got corona vaccine, isn't it? So why you got corona vaccine? It's for prevention of disease. You got this vaccine so that you do not acquire this disease. So for prevention of this, that particular drug was given. So for prevention. Suppose for diagnosis, okay? Suppose you are having pain in the movement of this side, your doctor is suspecting that they are getting kidney stone. So he has advised you, go for an IVT, intravenous thyroid. So this is one guy is injected today. And X-rays will be taken of this region, like 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 8 minutes, minutes interval, they will take X-ray. So what will happen? If there is a stone, there will be feeling defect. So this dye or this drug, a doctor is using for diagnosis of this kidney stone. Clear? But what we are now, we will be now discussing about the illicit drug. What are the means? Drug addiction is voluntary. Many times it happens without knowledge of who might become dependent or addicted to a particular substance. And I am giving you an example. Suppose you are having sleeping difficulties. Suppose you have possibility. I have asked you to take this medicine for 2 weeks, not more than 2 weeks. Now, after taking 1 or 2 tablets, the price is increasing. So, it's a very good thing. So after 2 weeks, you never visited me. Now unless you are taking medicine, I am not taking this medicine every day. So 2 years down the line, you feel that if you stop this medicine, absolutely there is no sleep, what there is distress, restlessness, anxiety, all these things come to. So without having knowledge also, you become an addict person. Drugs that are legal are helpful, illegal drugs are what is legal drugs? Example, I am giving for example. Alcohol is legal in Tripura, isn't it? But it's a banned substance in Bihar and in Gujarat. So, if alcohol is harmful there, Bihar and Gujarat, does it mean that?